celebration on the fourth Sunday in ordinary time. Welcome to all those who are accompanying us virtually through Facebook or YouTube. We are here at the church in a COVID secure manner as possible, with just a few members of the congregation and a server and a camera person. Today, we celebrate Him who speaks with authority and to whom we must give our undivided attention. And so, my brothers and sisters in Christ, to prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries, let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all.
Thank you. and reading from the book of Deuteronomy. Moses says to the people, "Your God will raise up for you a prophet like myself from amongst yourselves, from your own brothers, to him you must listen. This is what you yourselves asked of the Lord your God at Horeb on the day of the assembly. Do not let me hear again, you said, the voice of the Lord my God, nor look any longer on his great fire, or I shall die." And the Lord said to me, "All they have spoken is well said. Then I will raise up a prophet like yourself for them from their own brothers. I will put my words into his mouth, and he shall tell them all I command him. The man who does not listen to my words, but he speaks in my name, shall be held answerable to me for it. For the prophet who presumes to say in my name a thing I have not commanded him to say, or who speaks in the name of other gods, that prophet shall die." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The response to the psalm. Oh, that today you would listen to his voice. Harden not your hearts.
Oh, that today you would listen to his voice. Harden not your hearts.
Come, ring out our joy to the Lord. Hail the rock who saves us. Let us come before him, giving thanks. With songs, let us hail the Lord.
Oh, that today you would listen to his voice. Harden not your hearts.
Come in, let us kneel and bend low. Let us kneel before the Lord who made us, for he is our God, and we the people who belong to his pasture, the flock that is led by his hand.
Oh, that today you would listen to his voice. Harden not your hearts.
Oh, that today you would listen to his voice. Harden not your hearts as at Meribah, as on the day at Massah in the desert, when your fathers put me to the test, when they tried me, though they saw my work.
Oh, that today you would listen to his voice. Harden not your hearts.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul's to the Corinthians. I would like to see you free from worry. An unmarried man can devote himself to the Lord's affairs. All he need worry about is pleasing the Lord. But a married man has to bother about the world's affairs and devote himself to pleasing his wife. He is torn two ways. In the same way, an unmarried woman, like a young girl, can devote herself to the Lord's affairs. All she need worry about is being holy in body and spirit. The married woman, on the other hand, has to worry about the world's affairs and devote herself to pleasing her husband. I say this only to help you, not to put a halter around your necks, but simply to make sure that everything is as it should be, and that you give your undivided attention to the Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus and his followers went as far as Capernaum. As soon as the Sabbath came, Jesus went to the synagogue and began to teach. His teaching made a deep impression on them because, unlike the scribes, he called them with authority. In the synagogue just then, there was a man possessed by an unclean spirit and shouted, "What do you want with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." But Jesus said sharply, "Be quiet, come out of him." And the unclean spirit threw the man into convulsions, and with a loud cry went out of him. The people were so astonished that they started asking each other what it all meant. "Here is a teaching that is new," they said, "and with all authority behind it. He gives orders even to unclean spirits and they obey him." His reputation rapidly spread everywhere, through all the surrounding Galilean countryside. This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Taking up residence in the home of St. Peter. The archaeological remains of that home can still be seen today. Jesus is teaching in the synagogue, but then is interrupted. A man with an impure spirit who is in the synagogue starts screaming, and his voice is directed towards Jesus. I do wonder how we would react if that was to happen on church, or in church on a Sunday when we were all here together. For one, we'd probably have a church warden springing into action and removing the seemingly mad person from the church. After all, he's the sort of person most of us would avoid. Dirty, out of his mind, and bothering everyone who gets just a little bit too close. Living on the margins of sanity and living on the margins of society. But even in his demonic state, he knows exactly who and what Jesus is. Jesus of Nazareth, the Holy One of God. The Gospel tells us Jesus teaches with authority. And he gives his power over demons that serves to reinforce his authority. "Be silent," Jesus said sternly, and come out of him. The impure spirit shook the man violently, and come out of him with a shriek. The people were all so amazed. Now, I realize that a lot of people today would look at this account and endeavor to dismiss the demon possession as a primitive way of describing what we might call a psychiatric illness or a mental disorder of some kind. In other words, those of Jesus' time really never knew enough about medicine to make a positive diagnosis of a mental or psychological illness, and instead attributed such disorders to the realm of evil spiritual influence or demonic possession. Advocates of such a position are therefore quick to demythologize the biblical accounts of demon possession. The problem with this kind of thinking is Jesus. Being who he is, the Holy Son of God, was not limited by a lack of scientific knowledge or understanding. He knew exactly who and what he was dealing with, just as the demons clearly knew exactly who they were dealing with. And exorcism was notably a part of Jesus' mission here on earth. We've come a long way, and the positions are almost reversed, so much so that demons are either neglected or discounted entirely, with psychiatric, psychological, or sociological causes being the routine diagnosis for those who are mentally or emotionally ill today. Which brings me to a warning given by C.S. Lewis. There are two equal and opposite errors into which our race can fall about the devils. One is to disbelieve in their existence. The other is to believe and to feel an excessive and unhealthy interest in them. And they themselves are equally pleased by both errors. The spiritual realm is very real. Saint Paul, in his letter to the Ephesians, says, "For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms." He is saying that those who are not flesh and blood are evil, and their mission is to oppose and wage war against that which is of Christ and his church. And every one of us who belongs to him is a legitimate child. The goal? To get us away from Jesus, to have us live our lives in servitude and fear of them. You don't need to come into church screaming like a demonic to have gone into trouble through evil. The dangers of evil are all around, and most often evil exercises a subtle influence over the world. For example, how many people rather turn to their horoscopes in the morning to see how their day is going to be, rather than turn to God in prayer? Or perhaps have their tarot cards read to learn of their future? Because we as Christians trust in Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, and we have the indwelling presence of the Holy Spirit within us, evil cannot occupy our heart, soul, and mind. The Holy Spirit has full reign. But while evil cannot live within, its messages can be heard quite clearly, whispered into our ears. And it looks specifically for weaknesses and vices to exploit. Give evil half a chance, and it will wreck your life. Again, the goal is to get us away from Jesus and have us live our lives in servitude and fear of them. So it might be that the evil colludes with the alcohol or another form of dependency, or with the spirit of jealousy, greed, gluttony, envy, gossiping, ignorance, hatred, stress, a fear of loneliness. Together, they will destroy everything they touch. If they come together in a person who is unprotected, someone without faith, then the results can be even more horrific. People die, families are torn apart, false gods are worshipped as societies, and even whole nations are reduced to nothing. Humanity by nature is fallen and given to sin, so it's really not a very hard thing to exactly why you and I as believers are called to put on the whole armour of God and preach deliverance in Jesus. For he is the one who is strong enough to defeat all forms of evil and the prison it holds us to. He is more than able to set us free. And he shed his blood for our freedom from all manner of sin. So let us pray that God will come and set us free. Help us to renounce the sin that has been holding us back. In the name of Jesus, we put sin to death and trust in the infinite mercy of the deliverer, who said to put to the demons tormenting a man in Kirkland over 2,000 years ago, "Be quiet about it," so that we too may know the peace of mind from quiet. That state of right thinking that comes from God alone. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, but he was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified at Pontius Pilate, he suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Father in heaven, we lift our heart to you in your holiness and majesty, in your wisdom and power, in your love and faithfulness. We worship and adore.
We pray for your church throughout the world. Lord our God, in whom we live and move and have our being, help all believers to never forget that you are beside us, all throughout each day. Father, we thank you that you have spoken to us through the words of Scripture, and chiefly through him who is the living word of God. We pray for all leaders of our church, who through what they say and do influence the lives of others. We ask that they may be faithful to your gospel in heart, mind, and soul. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for all who lead our country. God our Father, grant them reverence for the truth, sensitivity to human need, and a true concern for the welfare of the communities they serve. We pray for all who serve our country in the armed forces. God our Father, grant them, through meeting danger with courage,
us always. Help us never to forget your presence through this day. Grant that all day, every word we speak may be fit for you to hear, that every deed we do may be fit for you to see, that even every thought of our mind and every emotion of our heart may be fit to bear your scrutiny. Grant that every pleasure in which we share may be so honourable that we can ask you to share it with us. So bring us to the evening time with nothing left undone and nothing badly done, with nothing to regret and nothing to make us ashamed. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Merciful Father, help all who suffer pain of body or grief of heart to find in you their help. We pray especially for those affected by the coronavirus and those in our parish, in particular Susanna Wright, Roger Argyle, Ruth Venner, Jean and Stephen, Jonathan, Brenda Goble and family, Harriet, Hugh, Nick and Susie, Ian, Liz, Adam, Lionel, Lizzie and family, Thassos, Carmen and Dennis, Jean Edwards, George Hirons, Michael East, Father Bill Wilson, Rachel, Richard and Cordelia, Kevin Stack, and Jeff Allen. As Jesus suffered pain in his body and healed it in others, help them to find their peace in him and to be renewed in strength of body and mind. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for all those who have gone before us in faith, especially all those who have died from coronavirus. And those whose anniversary of death occurs this week, especially Frederick Keith, Olive Quirk, Christopher Sharp, Edmund Mowbray, priest, William Walsham Howe, priest, Ewan Watmore, Edith Robinson, Edgar Ettridge. May they find their reward in your heavenly kingdom. Rest eternal grant unto them, O Lord, and let the light
perpetual shine upon them.
May they rest in peace
and rise in glory.
Let us now pray for all those whom we love and care in the silence and privacy of our hearts. Let us ask Mary, the Mother of the Lord, to pray with us and for us, as together we say, Hail
Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death.
Amen. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your Church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Thank you.
Pray, my brothers and sisters in Christ, that this sacrifice which is both yours and mine may be acceptable to God, the Almighty God.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
Let us pray. O Lord, we bring to your altar these offerings of ourselves. Be pleased to receive them, we pray, and transform them into the sacrament of our union. Through Christ our Lord. Do this in remembrance of me. same way after supper. He took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." The mystery of rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup. We thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit from Martin Archbishop and all your people, and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one to the tree. In the company of the Blessed Virgin Mary, St. Joseph, her spouse, St. Michael, the Archangel, St. Wilfrid, St. Richard of Chichester, and all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever through Jesus Christ our Lord. Behold, Jesus, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper.
Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and that I shall be healed.
Go forth, the Mass is ended.
Thanks be to God.
So by his cross and passion, we may be free.